foresee that in the post-pandemic, post-COVID era, the future of Indian cities, for us, it's like a wake-up call. The kind of urbanization that has been taking place relentlessly for the last 70 years, with very little future visioning of the cities, and the way the cities have grown and mushroomed, this is a real good time for us to go back to the drawing board and look at what we need to do to learn from what we have been through, not just in India but all over the world. I think the first thing that we really need to go back to the drawing board to do is to make our cities more livable. There's a phenomenal amount of slumification that has happened in Indian cities. So therefore, low-cost housing, decongesting the cities and not allowing people to concentrate within the periphery of the cities and getting our cities to expand, looking at newer cities, are some of the things that we need to do. We have to look at our public transportation system, the urban challenges of congested roads. We can't add any more cars. We have to look at more efficient public transportation system. Every city in India has a river support system. All those rivers are today offering black sludge instead of water. We have to clean up the rivers that support our cities. We have to create educational facilities, not mushroomed within a certain periphery, but spread out so that there is the ability for people to breathe as they live in cities. So I think this is a right time for us to really empower urban reimagination and to be able to do things based on the lessons that we've learned during the pandemic.
Hello and welcome to Fiki Fast Forward. COVID has really redefined the way we live, the way we work, the way we entertain ourselves. In fact, everything about life has suddenly become not a new normal, but a never normal. And in this environment, we've been having a series of insightful conversations as part of Fiki Fast Forward to reimagine so much of our lives. Today, I'm so happy to be joined by Miss Irina Vittal. She is someone who needs no introduction to Indian and international audiences. She sits on various boards. She consults with multiple companies. She helps organizations become the best version of themselves. And I've heard Irina speak so eloquently about the future of cities, of what we can and should be doing. So Irina, thank you so much for joining us today. We're looking forward to hearing you and your vision on cities. I've heard you say that 70% of the future of employment is going to come out of our cities. I know that it's a major driver of investment. I just wanted to ask you, what do you think is the future of Indian cities? How do you think we should be reimagining the workplace, reimagining our living space? And as you know, people are saying work from home is being called living at work. And we look at the way so many people live. You saw the impact of the pandemic on, you know, the residents of places like Dharavi. This is a wake-up call. This is a time for us to reimagine. So thank you for being with us at Fiki Fast Forward. Please share your thoughts.
So thank you, first of all, for inviting me. I think the interesting thing is how important they have been to our growth in the last 15, 20 years. Yet how reluctant we are as a country to think of ourselves as an urbanizing country. We are a reluctant urbanizer. And the pandemic, like every crisis, has just exposed and exacerbated the underlying structural weaknesses, including of our cities. So for example, the point that you mentioned, the impact on Dharavi, but more importantly, the injustice that we have demonstrated towards millions of our citizens, right? It's not an issue of compassion. It's a question of justice. It's a question of right. Clearly, we have been inclusive in our cities. We've had all these people working with us, but they've been invisible citizens. They've been people for whom there hasn't been a space. So one thing that the pandemic has clearly shown is how unjust our cities have been. By the way, this is not just true of Bombay, Bangalore, Delhi. It's perhaps also true of Singapore, where if you realize the second wave of pandemic attacks came around migrants. It's also true of UAE, where the biggest hits have been amongst migrants. So this piece of an unjust, non-inclusive city has played out not just in India's big cities, but also in some of the other cities across the world where migration is an issue. I think the other thing that the pandemic has shown us about our cities is how little we are investing in the future of our cities, and equally in the competency of people who run our cities. This is not a commentary on them. Each one of them has done an absolutely stellar job to manage the madness that the pandemic created. But you could see that we don't have capacity, we don't have infrastructure, we don't have a way of thinking about how to plan for big things when they hit cities. And this is only going to increase. We've been seeing the impact of rain, crazy rain, climate change, driven changes in monsoon on all our cities, whether it's Chennai, whether it's Bombay. We've been seeing the impact of earthquakes. We've been seeing the impact of a whole bunch of things. So this is the new normal for all of our cities, dense, crowded places, which are going to have disaster management as an annual exercise. And so to me, as we think about the future of our Indian cities, we need to keep these three things in mind. A, that we've been reluctant urbanizers in that we've never really thought of building out our cities in a systematic manner. Our cities are growing a kind of a jugaad way, inorganically. We don't have elected mayors. We don't have very good policies on planning. We don't have a great way of raising funds. We haven't really thought through what should be the shape of our cities. Second, our cities have not been inclusive. The migrant movement has just been a violent demonstration of that. And third, we haven't really invested in the future. So much of our public funds in cities goes in repairs of the roads, goes in cleaning of drains before monsoon, goes in a little bit of touch up here in education, a little bit of a road built there. But we really haven't reimagined what our cities are. So to me, this is a great time as each of us is reimagining our own companies, as each of us is reimagining our own lives. It's perhaps also a great time for India as a country to put cities at the center of the debate and to also reimagine them.
Thank you, Irina. That's a perfect opening. That it's not about compassion, it's about justice. And it's not just about growing the city, it's about reimagining, it's about designing. So tell us more in terms of, there's water supply, there's solid waste management, there's stormwater drains, there's parking, there's development of heritage areas, of parks, the beauty of the scenario. And then there's the hardcore aspects of electricity and the way we grow and zoning. Who do you think would be the perfect partners for us as we rethink this? So who's a role model in your mind? How do you see this process panning out if suddenly tomorrow all of us woke up and said, let's do this, let's build better cities? How do you see this whole process panning out?
So the real opportunity I see is actually to use cities as the best lever India has in the next couple of years to think about growth and about managing our fiscal deficit. Let me tell you what I mean by this. Before COVID, our gross capital formation had already dropped to 28%. And I can only imagine how low it will go this year when both the center and the state governments have absolutely no money. And to think about them driving investment is a bit of a long game. I also can't see how much of private investment will come in because capital utilization before COVID had dropped to 69%. And it is only one can only imagine how low it will go this year. So we are going to need, we're going to have pressure on where the investment into India will come from. Now, the good news is cities need all the money that we can give them. A couple of years ago, there was an analysis done which showed that to revive and grow our cities and get them ready for the future, India needed almost $2.2 trillion of investment. Even if a bit of it can come in the next couple of years, it might help drive growth. It might help create jobs, both of which are very, very critical. At the same time, to make this happen, the state will have to think about its own asset register. It will have to think about its land. It will have to monetize land. It will have to think about new ways of unlocking money over and above the debt that it can take from sovereigns who will be delighted to give India 40, 50-year loans to rebuild and reimagine our cities. Now, that's good news for the fiscal deficit, too. So to my mind, the real opportunity of cities in the coming years is not just to reimagine them for citizens and for investors, but also for the government to use this both centrally as well as at the state level, as an important driver of revival of growth. In fact, I find it quite fascinating that across the world, we're already starting to see countries make plans like this. There's a Chinese city which is declaring itself as, you know, city XYZ for 2025, and their promise is they're going to put in a couple of $1 trillion to make sure they are the first pandemic-free city in the world. There's another city which is talking about being the first 5G city in the world. So people are starting to think about using cities as interim drivers of growth when balance sheets of companies and of governments remain weak. Now, what could this look like? From the point of view of planning, I see three levels of planning. The first level is the growth plan for a city. You know, at the end of the day, a city is a value proposition that brings talent and investors together. And every great city therefore stands for something. It tries to attract investors of a certain kind, and then it tries to build a life, a way of living to attract talent that those investors want. Many of our cities haven't really thought through this. So what does Bombay want to be in the future when it's going to compete for investment, not just with Delhi, but also with Singapore and with Taipei and with Wuhan and with Shanghai? What does Delhi want to be as it competes with Dubai and with Singapore? So the first level of planning actually is, in many ways, you know, what kind of investors do you want? Who should come and invest here? And what will be the economic engines of our city? We need these economic plans. We don't think of cities as having economic plans, but they do. The second one is, of course, infrastructure. What kind of infrastructure do you need? And two things decide a city and its way of living. One is how much of travel do you want your citizens to make? So is it a transportation-led city? New York is an example. Old Mumbai is an example. Or do you see these as clusters of small cities where people travel and work within 5, 10, 15 minutes? So the transportation design of a city in many ways is the skeleton that defines how a city gets built. And then, of course, is the service level that you want to provide your citizens in terms of, as you were saying, greenery, in terms of water availability, power availability, schooling, medical, and increasingly climate resilience. If your city comes to a standstill 10 days in a year, that's not a happy city to be in. So the second level of planning we need to do is on infrastructure. And this is where India has so much of catch up to do, because in every one of our infrastructure areas, we have invested less than 10 to 15% of what we need to do. And in many ways, this is good news for us, because it basically means we can invest and create more jobs and create a larger economy as we build the world's largest transportation network, as we build the world's largest length of roads or stormwater drains or power, re-metering our power systems, relaying our pipes. Our pipes in Bombay were laid by the British. So all of this is actually good news for us. And then the third level of planning we need to do is on public services. For example, if you think about Singapore, even today, 80% of housing in Singapore is publicly owned and publicly rented. It is not owned and sold. It is rented out. The same thing is true of Shanghai. The same thing is true of New York. Large cities are unable to absorb poor people from outside or poor people from within unless they create services which are available but not necessarily owned. So you could imagine our cities having millions of units of rental housing. You could imagine millions of units of rental co-living. You could imagine shared transport. You could imagine shared infrastructure. So there's a third level of planning from an inclusion point of view, which creates spaces for not just the rich, but also for the poor. Because at the end of the day, you know, society has all kinds of people. So to me, the planning has to be at all three levels: economic, infrastructure, and inclusion.
Why have we failed? Why has this not happened in our country? And, you know, it seems like cities in the past have taught us about planning. You read about the great Indian cities, whether it was Mohenjo-Daro or you talk about Florence. Cities have always been an important driver of economy. They've had a team. They've understood that people must coexist. Why do you think we haven't been able to do that in India? And where would you start now?
That's such a great question because it does seem such a logical answer. And it's not just Mohenjo-daro. You had Mysore, you had Jaipur. These are great cities of the past. And one of the things that's common amongst all of these cities is there's an owner. The king of Mysore built the city. The king of Jaipur built that city. So the first thing that we struggle with is we don't have political owners of a city. When you take a decision on a piece of land, you're taking a decision for 50 years and 100 years. Our cities are run by some of the best IAS officers we have. And these four IAS officers have a tenure between, say, 6 months and 2 years. There is no way they have the political mandate to take long-term decisions on space, on land, on the amount of debt our cities should carry on their books. And therefore, even the best one amongst them, given the lack of political mandate, given often the lack of capacity, end up spending time on delivering what they can, which is repairing of roads, largely, and to some extent, managing, you know, one procession here or one procession there. The great cities of the world, if we want our cities to be great, they have to be run by politically elected and empowered mayors. We've had examples of this in Calcutta. We've had examples of this for a short period in Chennai. And every time we've seen this happen, it has worked. Why doesn't it happen more often? I think it's for two reasons. One could get me killed, but I'm going to say it nevertheless. I think it's the same reason that state governments or being at the head of state governments matters so much to political parties. There's a lot of money to be made in cities by all political parties, and a lot of it comes from land, and a lot of it comes from changing norms of land, because our land policies are ridiculously simplistic. And so every time you change the FSI of a land, you have an ability to tax it legally or otherwise. And so for a lot of, for the longest time, big cities have been the crucible, not just of growth, but also the crucible of raising political funds. And making that transparent has not been priority number one for a lot of political parties. I think the other reason, which is less worrisome, is that we still haven't, a lot of our political parties have still not understood the career paths of their cadre. We've already seen Delhi create a political leader of tomorrow. We already see that in China, the third most important person in the Politburo is the mayor of Shanghai. We've seen mayors, whether they are in Indonesia, Philippines, Italy, all of them rise to the top of their, to the top of the country. In India, this has only now started happening with state chief ministers. The day political parties realize that their best people will be groomed in cities, and so their path will be Panchayat Raj, district, city, state, and then Delhi. The day this becomes part of a political cadre, we'll see this happening. Till now, it has hung somewhere in the middle. There was clearly a path from Panchayat to Delhi. There wasn't a path from Bombay to Delhi.
What an extremely interesting analogy. I think you're talking about the church and the state and how, you know, they need to work together, or you're talking about a completely new governance structure, which is critical to really make, not just make the dreams come alive, but to ensure that they stay powerful realities and don't deteriorate or dissipate. So, like you said, this is something which calls for significant political change across the country. I don't know if it's possible, but I think it's very critical to think, to imagine, to focus. Is there an alternative path? Because empowering a mayor who's not so, you know, clear about what his political path is there a different methodology? Can we have citizens' committees? Can we make IAS officers and the governments more accountable? Can we build public blueprints of what we want to see in our cities? Can we reinvent smaller clusters of cities? Is there an alternate path, Irina? Because much as I would love to see it happen, I don't know how much we would be able to make it happen.
No, I think it's a very interesting question. So let me just separate out two pieces. Whatever we do, we have to take it to the citizens to align. So if you look at great cities and how they plan, they will actually have a plan, a 100-year plan, a 50-year plan, a 40-year plan, a 10-year plan. And that's how cities plan. And this is true of many cities in the world. It's not just America or Singapore or London, right? All great cities plan for 100 years, 40 years, 10 years, and then 2 years. And those plans are released in the public domain. And people are given time to comment. In a place like Singapore, they are put up in malls and people are asked to send comments. In a place like New York, anybody can go and access it. So the political alignment through citizen participation is very, very critical so that you don't have demonstrations later, so that citizens feel that their voice has been heard. And immaterial of whether the mayor is a technocrat or a politician, I think in the larger interest of India, this kind of a planning process is imperative. Otherwise, in many cases, we've seen that there's been an elite capture in India, which is it's only the rich and it's only a few vocal amongst the rich who actually define what happens to a city, right? And so oftentimes you'll find that citizens are talking about being able to cycle on the street on Sunday, and that's their idea of a good city. And on the other hand, you have a whole bunch of poor people living as their neighbors, sometimes visible, sometimes invisible, who don't have a water tap. And that's not discussed in the newspaper because elite capture had made cycling on the weekend as a demonstration of a city that is inclusive, right? So I think in India, we have elite capture in planning. And then we have a very poor way of listening to the voices of all of our citizens as we think of long-term plans. So that to me is a given. Now, your point of whether it can only be a politician versus a technocrat, I think you could have a combination of both. But the broader point is we need two things to happen at the top. We need competency because a city is about thinking. It's about making choices. You know, it's about raising funds. I don't know if you know, but the cumulative municipal bonds that our country has raised since independence is about $1.2 billion. And in, you know, and small towns in China, small cities in America have raised 10 billion, 15 billion municipal bonds. So we don't have the ability to raise debt. One of our cities in Western India raised $300 million a couple of years back, and it's lying in fixed deposit, and they have a negative interest on it because the poor guys have not been able to deploy it. So a lot of this is about the competency of raising debt, the competency of rethinking how to meter power and how to collect money so that your Uday scheme works. A lot of it is about, you know, how do you think about land use? So you need competency, and a lot of the competency is technical competency, which usually sits in agencies. It can be owned by the government, but it's not part of the state government. It's like BST, or it's like Hyderabad had a, you know, a bus and company which manages its own P&L. So you need competency, but you also need the legitimacy of taking decisions on behalf of citizens. Now you could have a thin layer of a politician or some bunch of ministers who sign off on the city, but at the end of the day, for a technocrat to take a 50-year decision is very, very difficult. No, so I think we will muddle along till two things will happen. One is till demographics make cities important, right? So right now, till you can get elected by winning in rural India, the voice of citizens in the cities was muted because they were not material to elections. In Tamil Nadu, which will be the first state in India to have more than 50% urbanization, it will be interesting to see when the voice of citizens become more important. And a young social media enabled citizen might perhaps be heard more.
No, and more Delhi. Delhi should have, like Delhi, you said.
Delhi is a great example where the voice of citizens has been heard because Delhi citizens are Delhi citizens. Or we will have a few more disasters, right? And some of our big cities will go underwater, and then we'll wake up and say, oops, we just lost 8% of our GDP. Could we have done something better? And then we'll revive. But I don't see an option to having political sign-off on 50-year decisions.
Dina, this has been a fascinating conversation. I think, you know, first you structured the entire scenario of reimagining what our cities would be. You spoke about the potential of an economic engine of the cities and therefore a methodology to even reduce fiscal deficit, to raise capital. We've had, you know, this fascinating discussion on positioning cities, on public services of cities, of being inclusive and even wondering, not just wondering, but planning and creating facilities for urban poor, an invisible section of society. And then you went on to the most critical options on how do we govern our cities. I believe that everything that you've said has been extremely critical. We hope that our viewers are going to watch and are going to talk about this and raise the level of dialogue about the way we plan our cities and the way we create our own future living spaces for ourselves and our children. Thank you so much for this conversation, Irina. I cannot but hope that everything that you've pointed us in the direction of somehow happens. And I'm not going to say somehow, because very shortly, you have inspired me to continue this debate, to make sure that we continue and have other voices come in, because this is so important that it cannot be contained to just 20 minutes. So I'm going to keep calling you back. Thank you so much for your time. Truly appreciate it. And namaste.
Thank you for inviting me. Namaste.